Now we're in Kristina. They have a new location. I didn't know that actually. So that's exciting because they've got so many things here. My fascination for music came when I was quite young, and the records were still kind of being used. It was actually CD era more than records. I started collecting slowly but surely, mostly like Detroit and Chicago stuff. The more I started playing, the more it became a thing for me to go check records, but it's almost exclusively secondhand only, because the new releases are widely available on digital media as well. And I feel like there is only one way to learn about old school music is basically see the original media, which is vinyl, which is records. If I'm in the shop and it's not maybe specialized on, you know, maybe it's not like divided nicely, like here, like early 90s rave, electro from 2000s, if there is no indication of what it is, I usually just go for the design. I was like, okay, what would you think this is like would be? Like, you know, like robotic, anime. When I dig records, it's purely for DJ. Of course, you know, I have records for listening, it's mostly albums. But when I drop in for a particular shop, I usually go for something I know I can rip and make into digital stuff. Well, I start with my sort of favorite and preferable section is like 90s to 2000s techno. Jumps right into my eyes, jacks up beats. Which is obviously like the legendary Dutch label from Miss Jax. What I really like about it, that most of them have the cartoons by Alan Oldham, DJ 2000, from Detroit. And it's always something like very, very futuristic and extremely adventurous. There's like lots of action, lots of mimics going on, you know, like somebody with a weapon or somebody's running away or breaking in. I would sometimes I just go through the records just to see the animation part. I think artwork is an important part of it, but there is also some charm around like completely anonymous records where there's like one number, like one or like two. But I think particularly 90s aesthetic is just kind of cool, and it's really like on its own. You can totally see that it's like from older time or maybe 2000s, like showed here, or like sometimes you can tell if it's from UK, from the UK, or from Germany. You know, there's some certain eras that indicate that. It's quite a nice catalog, actually. Inigo Kennedy. Haven't seen him in ages, by the way. DJ Shuffle Master is also worth checking. Electronic music does repeat itself a little bit, and I think it's important to go back and see the original idea, where it kind of came from. And I'm sure they would be listening to 70s and 60s to get the new ideas too. Techno Drone International. ZYX, yeah. ZYX Records, which is German stuff, but I didn't know about their sub-label, so we're gonna check that out. An EP name has like a funny name, like Yummy, and I just want to know what it is. Like here, it's called Yummy. And I don't exclusively look for techno or anything. Like I prefer to blend them. I really like to go to UK section and find maybe some kind of dubstep or like later forms of jungle, you know, or actually the opposite, early forms of it, like early 90s rave as well, because, you know, I wasn't able to go to the UK until 2017. I've been like digging as much as like stuff from here. You know, there is obviously like known ones, like I don't know, Doc Scott or whatever. But of course, you don't know all the like more underground stuff. I never grew up with it, so like we'll try to find some pieces from here. Here's a 50-pound white unknown no name record. I love it. Of course, yeah, it does say it's Sound Boy in it. So I even think I know what kind of sample it will have, but I'm curious to check it. Fluke Bullet, oh my God, this is like my personal classic. If you watch the video, it's the craziest thing ever. The most beautiful music video I've seen in the UK, I think. So it's like about like car players but like in virtual reality, and it all ends with that they kind of drive into each other, but then the game stops at that very point, and everything looks super flashy and fast, and yeah, it's pretty mental. Like, I would definitely recommend watching it. I think I'll buy it just because I don't have it on vinyl. Also, like, stuff like that, like, I don't know, if it doesn't intrigue you, then what will, you know? Like, I think that's interesting. So, like, for me, yeah, like, crate digging is like something between recognizing something you already know and like trying to find something that you've never seen, like stuff like that, you know? I remember I spent pure 5 hours in the old shop in Berlin, which is closed now. I unfortunately forgot the name, but there was a few people who worked there. And I remember in the early days, TVS1 would spend like days there, you know? It would be like a secret room. People would go and for the featured sort of artists, they would go and look for it. And I think that's kind of cool. Like, and I wish I had more time and access to do that. But as, you know, when I can, I try to visit, especially shops I haven't been to. Yes, this man is cool. I closed a few of my sets with Seal, and this particular one is. Has just lots of mixes and remixes and dubs, which, you know, that means there's no vocal, and it's usually a very long version. Don't think I'll check that one, because I have a few. Just gonna check something called Electro Clash real quick. That looks really cool. Space Lava promotional copy. Yeah, promotional copies are also like, kind of like reminds you of, I don't know, of that era where you would print something called promotional copy and not just send it on email, which is, I find this quite fascinating, because we like in our generation we can give like test press to each other, but that's so rare, because today the pressing plants give you maybe 2-3, and that's not enough, you know. You can't just go to your friend DJs and promote. Okay, this looks really interesting. I don't know the artist. I can see it's Gigolo, International DJ Gigolo Records, so definitely this kind of more bouncy stuff, like DJ Hell sort of thing. So we just moved to this £1 record section, and this is, I would say, this is a perfect place to find like a cappellas. But yeah, there's so much music, I don't know how to keep up with everything. And it's funny how, like, in the pop music or like rap or other genres, it's totally okay to like work with others. Whereas in our genre, it's often called ghost producing, and that's like a no-no thing, you know? And I don't know, I think collaboration and working with someone, like for example, SRVD do, you know, like Matt Edwards with a person who sings. I think that's awesome, and it just breeds more creative like flow. I like the color of this. Percussion solar mix. Percussion solar mix was 6 minutes long. Sounds good to me. I think we're gonna check this bunch, if you don't mind. All right, first record I picked up. So it has like a very long intro, so it's easy to mix it in whenever. It's like very DJ friendly stuff. And then short sample, back to groove. I like that. I would jump through different sort of levels of it, right? Like this, to get an idea of how long it is, how does it develop, you know. I'm quite an easy one. I wasn't a person that would buy more than less, definitely, for sure. And then sometimes I end up with things that lie there forever. But then I would either sell it or give it as a gift or something to someone, you know, who wants it. Okay, so now I'm gonna check this. That's pretty tight electro. I always check out sounds faster, just to, you know, if there is lots of vocals, sometimes things become a bit too silly when you send them up. So I usually check that before I even consider anything further. What else? Second side. That sounds also really nice. Just kind of, I imagine some kind of like old chiptune game almost, you know, that you have to like solve a quest, something like that. Okay. Prince of Persia, you know. Okay, let's go to the next one. This is the one called Techno Drone International, which is a, I believe, a sub-label to ZYX Records in Germany. Yeah. Yeah, definitely. I don't know how crazy I am with these arpeggios going on, to be honest. This is where it gets a bit too trance happy, you know? It's hard to say. I think every DJ has to be very careful. Anyone who works with music has to be very careful with this genre. Like, I don't like this, I don't like that, or only like this. It's really all about the individual record and individual production, you know. Some of my most favorite artists have records that I really don't like. And it's just because of either instrument or sounding or like the way they pattern it together, like, just doesn't appeal to me. And I think maybe this one is the case. Even though the idea is great. All right, the next one is this Yummy record that I thought sounded really cool. This is totally summer vibes, isn't it? Records called Sludem Productions. So that's not techno or anything. I chose a different genre for this. Bass music. It's pretty mad. Hi. I don't think I'm able to use that in my set, to be honest, but I was really curious to see how they differ between vocal and instrumental mix, just to kind of like give it a listen. Sometimes I'm just curious, really. It doesn't have to be all about techno DJ set. Like that stuff, for example, I would play it on the radio, like instrumental version. And it would actually mix well in techno. You could easily put like 4-4 on this, and this would spice the 4-4, so like together that would be interesting, as you know, sound wise. The white label record, we don't know what it is. Sound Boy for £50.
It's Jason K
is the artist. Jason K, okay. Well, I'm curious, you know, either way. Yeah. Always 16 bar introduction, guys, always. In the entire drum and bass and jungle world, you can like count it and it will be always 16. This That's sick, isn't it? That's so sick. Let's see what the other side is. There's also some of my friends. They buy that kind of record and then play it in 33 and just like experiment with the wrong like speed on it, of it. So let's see what's going on here. Okay, wow. Strong start. It's like some kind of flute or something. That's kind of cool. I'm not sure if it's 45 or 33. There's not much information about actual music. There is this kind of conceptual description. Yeah, there is like information and duration of the song, so they call it song. And then there is like lots of explanation about the color yellow, the color blue, red. I don't know, it's kind of cool. That sounds like another quirky banger I found, you know. Maybe I just like maybe it's just my thing. Yeah, I'm glad I picked it up because it's pretty weird. Fluke bullet. There is an original, but this one in particular has like three other versions of it, as I can see. I think I know all of them. I just haven't played it and I haven't listened to it for a while. I think this one is original, like the one I know best. It's just so kind of dreamy, but also so driving at the same time. I don't know, I think it's like legendary UK production. One of the guys has played with Depeche Mode and toured with them, yeah. So it's kind of like, it's the cinematic start, but like it builds to some new cool energy. And it teases you with a kick drop and then it stops again and then, yeah, it's, everyone should have a copy. I'd probably play it in this range. This one, I think we found in, was it Electro Clash section or was it One Pound section? One of them. I think Electro Clash section. Wow. Yeah, it's... I imagine this for some like early hours when people are quiet, almost about to go home. I think that would work really well. Then there's this one, Multiply Records, for where we have Norman Cook remix and I think you mentioned, was it Fatboy Slim? That's what I also kind of like about old school stuff or like secondhand records in general. You can kind of see it had already some kind of history at the previous owner. Sometimes they have their own comments on it, and it's like really funny to read. I had one once that said like "Mental Morning Banger" on it. It was written in hand. I was like, listen to it. It's like, yeah, it is definitely morning banger. So yeah, it's pretty. It's like a part of digging, I find, is to kind of read what the original owner or the previous owner, what they think about it. if they write some comments. So, I feel like I'm digging into some past with it, you know. What's another track like? That's crazy. Good production. I just don't think it's exactly my vibe. And we are actually missing some of the information here because catalog number and name is a bit blurred. You know, it's not been printed well, or like it's disappeared with years. But I can see the track name is gonna be "Who's in My Face." That's kind of cool too. So let's hear. I think it. Could be maybe drum and bass record, oh? Or like breaks.
The final frontier.
Nice, we have Star Trek sample in it. Perfect, I like that. I'm a big fan of Star Trek, so that's kind of cool. I didn't expect this. MC. I think I would actually throw it in the set, maybe like in a, like a smaller party with, you know, people who are very open-minded. Yeah. Like this come from 1 pound theory. So I have most of it, I have no clue what it is. Really strong. It's very, this minimal loopy era for sure. Mid-2000s sort of stuff. I can't understand if I like it or I don't. I like the assertive drums in it for sure. Oh no, it's actually, no, more like acid line. The reason I grabbed this record is because of the label, Positiva. It's always full on. Oh. Always has this crazy trance, old school stuff in it. Who's it produced by? James Horner. Yeah. Rave! A break? Of course something epic in the between. Yeah, I think this is again a bit, as we talked some other records, it was like slightly too trancy for me and slightly too old school. Yeah, this end is really intense though, like it can repeat itself a little bit, but instruments are great. I probably remove some of the mid and let the bass do the job. Depends on the mixer, of course, but I would definitely EQ that a bit if I played it out. So. Yeah. That was sick. That was a good digging session for sure. Yeah.
And I started to work when I was 16 and I spent all my money and turntables. We meet some friends and we do like trips to Barcelona to find some records. There was a guy from Zaragoza and he called you like at 2 in the morning. Hey, Andres, are you home? Yeah, can you bring some money? I have some records. Yeah, yeah. And then I go to his band and we listen tracks until 5 a.m. or more. Sometimes it was crazy. It's like a spiritual thing. Yeah, you come here, you listen. But I want to spend here like a lot of hours. It's not just a thing I go just for 15 minutes.